Hello everyone, and thank you for coming today. So I work on a specific kind of memory, and that is working memory, or sometimes referred to as short-term memory. This is our ability to keep in mind information that is no longer available in the environment for very brief periods of time to guide our behavior. And this is a very important cognitive function, so it underlines our abilities to reason and problem solve. However, we are only aware of the importance of this cognitive function when things go wrong. For example, we've all experienced a situation when we're looking for our glasses only to find them on top of our heads. And some other examples here. And importantly, we usually use our working memory or our short-term memory to locate objects in the environment. For example, looking for your keys in a kind of cluttered kitchen, for example. So we wanted to create a task that we can then pick up or look at memory performance when people have to remember objects and their locations. So the task is fairly simple. It's done on a touchscreen computer or on a tablet. Participants are presented with these kind of colored shapes or fractals. They have to keep in mind both the kind of how they look like and also where they appear on the screen. They will go away, followed by like a few seconds, sometimes up to 4 seconds of delay. And then afterwards, two fractals or two of these objects will appear in the center of the screen. What participants have to do is pick the item that they held in memory, for example, here at the top one. So they have to pick this item. Oh, can I show with the mouse? And then importantly, they have to drag it to the location that they remembered it to be. So in summary, this is kind of what the task is. Participants see one or three items, keep it in mind for a few seconds, and then afterwards, first pick the item they remembered. So here we can look at kind of how accurately they remember the object, object kind of shape and identity. And also we can look at how precise their localization performance is. So this is how precise their memory for that location is. So we used this task to and tested a group of patients with Alzheimer's disease and mild cognitive impairment and compared their memories or their performance with a group of healthy participants, age matched, so same age. So if we look at first just localization identification, so whether they remembered what fractal or what shape was in their memory, patients are performing as well as healthy controls. Importantly, we can look at kind of their precision for the location, memory for locations by looking at the difference in where they actually located the object as opposed to where it actually appeared in the first array. And this gives us like a precision measure with higher kind of errors corresponding to worse performance. And what we find is that patients are actually making or have less precise memories, so they're making larger errors in locating these objects. However, we want to know what is causing this kind of impairment. Is it just because that they have imprecise memories, or is there some other underlying factor? Now, to show or demonstrate different kinds of things that can go wrong, I'm just going to quickly show a video of one of our students actually performing the task. So just to recap, participants see, for example, one item, it goes away, then two items appear, they tap on the one, and they drag it to the location they remembered. Sometimes, importantly, they see three items, again, remembering where they appeared, goes away, and now, again, they have to pick the one and drag it to the location. Now, this is the trial of interest. In some of the trials, what happens is participants are presented with these three items, remember this item specifically. So the participant picks the right item, but drags it to the location of another item in memory. So they remembered kind of precisely where the objects were. They remembered what they look like, but they don't remember which items went to which locations. And what we call these kind of errors, we call them swaps in memory. So it's not that they completely forgotten about these items, they just forgotten which went where. And when we look at this kind of errors, we see that actually patients with Alzheimer's disease or mild cognitive impairment are actually making more of these swap errors in memory. So it's not that they're completely forgetting what was where, it's just that they're making kind of these misbinding or swap errors in memory. And importantly, other people in our group have also shown that you get kind of similar pattern of impairment, that is increased swaps in memory, in a group of people that was mentioned. So these are patients with familial Alzheimer's disease who have 100% chance of developing Alzheimer's disease. So they tested, our colleagues tested a group of patients or individuals who are at risk of developing Alzheimer's but don't have Alzheimer's yet. And what they found is that, again, this kind of increased swap errors in their memory. Now, we didn't ask whether this kind of swap increase is specific to Alzheimer's disease pathology or not. And to do that, we looked at another group of patients who have kind of disorders of the same parts of the brain that is associated with Alzheimer's disease. And this is a group of patients who have kind of temporal lobes. So this is the part of the brain that is affected in Alzheimer's. And they had had this part of the brain taken out due to many different reasons, for example, hippocampal sclerosis or epilepsy. And what you see here is just that kind of all the lesions or where that part of the brain was taken out in all the 25 patients that we tested. So we hypothesized that since the same part of the brain in this group of patients is kind of affected, then we should see the similar pattern of impairment. And in fact, they performed the same kind of task, the object location task. And what we found here, now patients are in pink, what we found is that, again, these patients are making much more swap errors. So what you just need to know for here is that this is just kind of where they located all the objects, and 0 and 0 is where the other items in memory were located. And you see that patients are actually placing a lot of their responses at the place of these other items in memory, demonstrating that this kind of error, this kind of swap error, is possibly specific to Alzheimer's-related pathology. Now, the next question that we asked is, again, if we want to kind of hypothesize or say that this kind of impairment is specific to Alzheimer's disease, so it's like a cognitive marker for Alzheimer's disease, then we shouldn't see it in other neurodegenerative disorders. For example, here in Parkinson's disease. So what we did is we tested a group of patients with Parkinson's disease, again on the same touchscreen task, hypothesizing that in this group of patients we shouldn't see what we saw in Alzheimer's disease patients. So again, participants performed the same task, and what we found here, unlike Alzheimer's disease patients, patients who had Parkinson's disease were actually, even at the stage of picking which item was in their memory, they're significantly impaired compared to healthy controls. And what we found is that they're also impaired at localizing or placing these objects on the screen. But importantly, when we look at these kind of swap errors, we see that actually Parkinson's disease patients are performing similarly to our Alzheimer's disease, to healthy controls, unlike Alzheimer's disease patients. So we then also did a similar study, like the one we did with the people who are at risk of developing Alzheimer's. And we took a group of people who are at risk of developing Parkinson's disease. And these are a group of individuals with rapid eye movement sleep disorder. So this is a disorder. So when we usually sleep, we have sleep paralysis, so we can't move our bodies. And this group of patients actually kind of move in response to their dreams, and they're actually usually very violent. So I'm just going to show a quick video of one of our patients. So as he's sleeping, he's actually now slowly going to act his dreams out or actually move violently around. So as you can see, so he moves around until kind of he wakes himself up. So this kind of disorder is only 0.5% of the population will develop this disorder, but this is a very highly high risk factor for developing Parkinson's disease. So after around, for example, in this study, they found that after about 10 years being diagnosed with this disorder, about 80% of these patients will develop Parkinson's disease. Therefore, we said that this group of patients should perform similar to our Parkinson's disease patients and not to the group of patients who have Alzheimer's disease. Now, this time they did a slightly more boring task of memory. Instead of objects and locations, they had to remember orientations and colors. So it's the same concept, and we can do the same kind of analysis. And when we look at their performance, we saw that actually what happens is that these patients who don't have Parkinson's yet are performing similar to our Parkinson's disease patients, and that is they're rapidly forgetting everything in their memory. So the chance of actually not remembering anything is higher than healthy control participants. And they are not making more swap errors when compared to, for example, Alzheimer's disease patients. So just to quickly summarize, I hope that I have shown some evidence showing that using this kind of very simple behavioral task, we can kind of dissociate between healthy aging compared to Alzheimer's disease, where they're making more of the swappers, compared to Parkinson's disease, where they're making more guesses or random responses. And kind of these are just the beginning of research projects looking at kind of whether we can use these tasks as cognitive markers for different kind of neurodegenerative disorders. So, thank you.